This is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending today's webinar on the episode 16th of the BusinessX learning series, Invest, Scale and Value and Exit. Today's topic is on business valuation, myths and facts. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Sonali. And thanks for hosting this every week. This is every Saturday edition where we talk about invest. How do you invest in businesses and how investors behave? And second is value, which is how do you value your businesses? And today's topic is about that. And then we also talk about scale and exits. So valuation is a very unique discussion, and I think you need to understand that it would have a different meaning for different set of companies and different stage of companies. Particularly with this period of COVID going on and other things happening, we're getting at BusinessX two kind of inquiries a big time. One, a lot of startups which were thinking of raising capital at this stage are coming to us and saying and rediscovering their value and understanding where they stand and how they can attract capital and so forth. So there are a lot of what I call the growth and the scale companies which are raising money, and they want to see their valuation, how it needs to be done. And then we have a lot of companies which are coming to us, and they are largely between BusinessX is known for the, I would call it the entry to mid-sized companies. And they're coming to really exit the business, and they're also looking to do valuation. Now, these are very two different phenomena. And then there are what I call performing assets, which are performing and making money and they're ready for scale and they're going the next level. And then there are businesses which are non-performing and they're losing money. And the non-performing also have further two types. One, I think there are businesses which are currently not performing from a financial performance viewpoint, which means that they're not profitable, but they are also divided into two parts. One, I think companies which have a large opportunity over the years to really become profitable and so on and so forth. So they might be in a life journey of gestation where they are not at this stage making money, but there is a future to make money. And then there are companies which have reached to a point where there is no current hope unless and until the full restructuring or recapitalization or turnaround kind of these businesses can happen. So these are mix of businesses, and valuation becomes a very different structure. So I today thought that I'll probably take multiple myths which are coming in the valuation and talk about a few things which are very important for people to know, and especially if you are at a stage where you are looking for value for your businesses, how this can really help and benefit you. So one of the references I want to really give to everybody, if you really want to refer anybody, I would say in the valuation space, who's a real genius, is Damodaran. I think if you've not read him or not reading about him, I think you should really go and refer. This is a source where I would do all my reference point. I think he has done some real good work in understanding how valuations should be done. And his understanding level of valuations for different class of companies is absolutely genius. And I've met a lot of people in valuation. I think they don't have the depth of the knowledge and structure. So I've picked a few things from Damodaran also, but a mix of a few things we will discuss on discussion today. And I've also some experiences of my own because we deal with a lot of these small and medium-sized businesses, how they really look at it. And so we will talk about a few things. And if you have questions, you please go on in the Q&A box and just ask your question. And the end of it, I'll do maybe a 20-minute discussion and then we'll start taking some questions. And I'd like to answer if you have a specific question about your own business, how you want to really see your valuation and things like that. So starting point is that valuation is always about, it's a quantitative approach where valuation itself is an objective. This is one of the areas which I really learned from Damodaran, because fundamentally, most of the times we really stack up our numbers to really reach out to objective or valuation we want to do that. And this is what the first is, that this becomes a structure. This is an approach which everybody would take. And this can be sometimes very biased, and it can be extremely biased because just adding on numbers doesn't give us the final outcome. So one has to really think through that this is a way of valuation. I mean, people set an objective of what they want to have value for, and do the numbers actually stack up on that? Another area which is a myth, that the valuation is once done is what you have. I mean, people come to us with valuation which they've done last year to last year, And they still feel that the business was at that level. And they continue to do that because, or rather they would sometimes increase because their last year revenue to this year revenue has increased. So they would feel that the last year value to this year value would have also increased, right? This is myth. Again, a myth because valuation is also subjective to a lot of other things. It is largely broadly from economy. If people are coming at valuation at this hour, where I would say the businesses have churned and changed. And what is your industry doing? Is your industry in a long-term hit situation or a mid-time or a positively hit where you are? Everything has changed. Even if somebody is taking up numbers which are even March 2020, I would say this has changed drastically over the next 4 or 5 months. And it can be for some reason, some business has gone up and some business has gone down. So this is largely broadly how the economy is doing, how your industry is doing, and also what stage of market we are in. Are we in the bullish market? Are we in the moderate market? Are we in a recession? So depending on these things, your valuation would constantly change. I would say if you're really in the line of doing and raising capital for yourself or even in the market to sell your business, you need to really take a quarterly approach minimum to really set that your valuation is right or not at this stage. And you have to have a good practitioner who can really set some valuations and also understand the market condition, the demand side, and so on and so forth. So a lot of these are very important to do that. Another area which is a myth that is a very scientific way of doing valuation. I think the science is just one part of it. I think it's a art and the science combination. You know, art is really the softer sides of businesses, and I'll talk about in the future in the further structure. And science is about stacking up your numbers. If you not create a combination of both, your value would not become. The more quantitative is better, I think. Answer again, no. Rather, I would say the softer side is much more prominent at this moment. You know, I've seen businesses being valued on founders who are the leadership team, how nimble the organizations are, how scalable the businesses are, how resilient the businesses are. These are things are getting more valuation just in absolute numbers. So a lot of times people just follow the numbers, and I feel that they forget about this other part of that. How your business is ready to be transferred to somebody. And these are things are becoming more and more important for somebody to really look at it. Another area which is a myth is that a lot of times the way people do valuation and then they get a feedback from the market and they don't trust that feedback because they feel that the markets are sometimes wrong in terms of assessing their valuation and things like that. Actually, markets are always right. So you need to really see that something is gone wrong with your approach to valuation. I've seen people getting a lot of frustration because they set a very different valuation for their businesses because they believe in or their numbers are telling them. But there is a lot of other things which are part of their businesses which create. And especially in Indian businesses, I think there are a lot of complexity in the businesses. Which really surprises me that even great businesses are so complex and design-wise that the capability of transferring and transparency of the businesses becomes a big, big challenge. Even the numbers look very interesting. Everything is good, but still a lot of investors would shy away from these businesses because they look so complex in that nature. Another area which is very important is that how do you really justify the beliefs? And beliefs are objectivity and quantitativity. So how do you really bring these two beliefs together? And then only because it's all about demonstrating next 5 to 7 years of the business and how 5 to 10 years your business is going to be taking. Unless and until you really bring in strong objectivity to it, you know, how this objectivity and predictability, both are very important part of the next 4 or 5 years of your journey of the business. And that's something which to me is more critical. It's not really about the absolute revenue, which we need to think. It's the objectivity of that in terms of how you can really demonstrate. That's why companies which are SaaS companies, you know, companies which have a certain amount of ability to demonstrate that the same subscriber would continue to consume or consume even higher in 4 or 5 years time now, get more valuation. You know, sometimes people get surprised and a lot of people come to me and say, these very young companies are able to get that kind of valuation. But if you really look at these businesses, they have a subscriber business model. And they have demonstrated on a small sample, they've demonstrated in the last 6, 7 months or 1 year that these subscribers continue to purchase. And then now they continue to buy for the next 5, 10 years. And they would continue to purchase more. They would continue to spend more. These are the trigger points which would set some exceptional valuation of businesses. A lot of businesses have a great present, but they are not able to present a better future. So I think a valuation is a combination of your past performance, your good present, and a great future. if you are able to get this piece right, if you have a past which tells me that there is a consistency in what you're doing now, you have a good present, you have a reasonably good present, and you have a very strong, extraordinary future reflected, you get the topmost value. And you need to really ask yourself, is your business ready for demand? If your business was, say, past had, say, consistency, but your today is not looking good, and a lot of people actually come to raise capital or want to transfer the companies when this has actually happened. It, to me, they have actually eroded the value, right? So because they were doing okay at the past, but last 1 or 2 years, their business has gone down, and then now they want to exit or find that thing. So it's not a good situation to win. And more importantly, they would not be able to demonstrate the future, right? So how the future is going to be done. So first, we need to go and correct the model itself. Why this decline has started, why the company has gone down, and how we have an idea to really take that business back to entirety and continue to show growth. So this is, to me, a very strong fundamental of how do we approach valuation. Another area which is that there are standard multiples. A lot of people, almost every discussion I have with somebody who wants valuation, they would start with what you get a multiple in food, what you're getting multiple in this. And these are perceptions they would read either by listed companies, how their multiples are there, or a lot of other companies, and they take that as a myth. Answer is that no business is same. You can take reference points of these multiples. That's all right. But every business to me is extremely unique. Every business is led by a unique leader. It also has a unique marketplace to operate. He has a unique customer base to do that. So no two businesses are same. No two firms are same, really speaking. And how do you really put the differentiation on that? You can take a little bit of a reference point, in the past transactions and multiples needs to be done. But normally, these would have to be assessed independently. So don't really just because something happened in your industry at a certain multiple and you heard this in the business, you think that your firm is also likely good to get that one thing. And this is one of the big, big problems, especially in the startup to mid space. A lot of people just to hear a news and say, oh, XYZ delivery company got so much evaluation at certain and I think we are also similar to that. Actually is a myth. It has no reality to me because this comparison is a wrong comparison to do. There is a recently a company came to me as its immediate competition was valued at a certain value. And they were two different businesses. One was extremely completely on technology and one was very classic model. While their numbers at the top line to me looked same, but they were very different companies. They were differently placed companies. This company would have ability to demonstrate a very strong growth in the next 5-7 years, has a possibility to better control the business and operations. This classic model was very different. It had a lot of other inherent challenges, which was there. So really don't compare just the multiple. You need to go into depth of the business and try to do that. And sometimes there is not so much of a space for multiple companies to be really in the business. Space just becomes overcrowded and there is no more acceptability. And the first few would get bigger and bigger, like this what happened in the co-working space, right? So first few, four or five companies really got exponential valuations. And then a lot of people just rushed into getting to co-working because everybody wanted to do WeWork and things of that nature. And look at them. Most of them are collapsing. They're not even get a single buyer place. So and the market actually has also gone on the south, and the valuations are also going south. So you have to be really, don't really just rush into, because there's somebody who's in the same space got some valuation and you want to do that. Another is a myth, which I touched upon earlier also, is that everything is financial attribution, and a lot of times great balance sheets, which are financially telling you everything right, still don't get good valuation because there is a lot of other things which are very important. And some of them I will share. Management team and founders to me is extremely important. How much is the strength, depth, profile, background, their experience, their commitment levels, what is that telling you is extremely important. Capability and intention of the team, its team is also extremely important, how the team is aligned to the growth cycle of the business. Growth in the past growth, and what is this analyzed growth telling you, what kind of numbers you're doing or year-on-year basis. Reputation and brand equity, what kind of a brand you built and how you enjoy the equity. And this is the most difficult part to really build some kind of a number around it, because it's very difficult to measure non-tangible assets, right? Very, very difficult, you know, and it becomes a, and this becomes a more art part of it, because you need to really understand that entire thing. What is the firm size? How do you really, how you spread? How far you've gone in? Are you spread thin or you are clustered? Things of that nature. Almost every company which is coming to me, I'm giving them a cluster approach. Today, I had a call with a good company which is in EV vehicles, and they are coming with the product. And I said, don't worry, just focus on one state and capture that one state, right? While you have ambition to go everywhere, but don't go everywhere, because you have only this window. If you see the EV space, this window is only for 2 and 2.5 years, because it's not that the Hero doesn't know, the Bajaj doesn't know, the other companies don't know, TVS doesn't know that electric is the future. But they are, because they are so much invested in the classic technologies that they don't want to really make it too big. But they also know that by 2025, it is must that only EV vehicles would be sold, because this is a guideline by government, Supreme Court, and the things like that. So what could happen is this is 2-year window. In 2-year window, while they would continue to sell their own conventional old technology, because they have a lot of investment riding on that. And so new players have this window of 2 years, 2.5 years, and they can, if they can spread thin, they can go all over, which would not matter to Hero or Bajaj or any other big OEM, because you're just small and you hear them there and they would not be there. But imagine if you became and gone to one state and build a strong, deep cluster in that, and you actually created an entry barrier for any person to enter, right? Then they have to buy you out, right? So the maximum valuations would come there or invest with you. So a lot of these times, if I have seen in last particular 25 years, either you were a strategic entry barrier advantage, or you were strategic from a early go-to-market capabilities, or something else which gave a significant advantage to a buyer. And that's where the valuations jacked up. You know, so you really have to see what are you doing to, one, keep the competition on the fence, and second, make it so attractive for a competition to look at this. Most of the strategic buyouts in the industry really comes from there. You need to also see what is an organizational design today, you know, because I've seen that there's one particular deal I was doing, working on, and that deal failed because at the later stage, the buyer really realized that he will not be able to pick this deal because it's so complex to control the business. And I'll talk about this even more detail. You know, another thing which is very important is that a lot of people say this, how is the multiple of revenue approach really works, you know, and multiple of revenue approach is most of the time. And this is another big myth where people think that they are buying business, which is today. Actually, it's a mistake. Nobody wants to buy a business, which is today. They want to buy a business, what this business today can do in future, right? So if you show your business for today, I don't want to value it, because this is something which, this is your business and you brought to this level. And I'm taking at this stage and I would take it to the next level. And I want to really see where this from today to go to the next level. That's why discounted cash flows and all these things were so popular, because fundamentally it's your demonstration and how convincingly you demonstrate a business which is today would go to the next 5 years and continue to rise and grow and over the time. So that's something which is extremely important. And unless and until you have very clear structure that you are able to demonstrate somebody that this isn't that thing. Another area which is very important is just not the precise value of the valuation would make a sense to me. Me, I would give more marks to the deal structuring than just a purchase price, right? Purchase price is just a number. And the comfort is the deal structuring. How you would structure the deal, what comfort the investor is getting into the deal, that to me is equally important. So when you are discussing valuation, you need to also discuss in the same sense, what is the deal structure? If they don't come in a combination, I think sometimes the comfort you get from a deal structuring, this is very important for an aspect. So this is where the value would really come in. Another thing which is that, yeah, so another approach which I've seen where a lot of these business resale people are coming to us. And this is very unique when I talk to them. So the typical example would be somebody come and say, I was running a restaurant and I want to sell that business now. And I would ask that, what would be you expecting as a value of the business? Well, they don't know, but they would just calculate what they've invested. And when they say what they've invested is a value, is actually their perception of value, right? It's a perception that I invested so much and I want at least that to come in. And they don't understand that people are not interested in what you invested. I mean, you can do a lot of mistakes. You can do a lot of burn in your working capital and a lot of other things. They're not at all interested in that. So don't perceive your own value by just by your investment or what you want from it. So there is a desire value also. A lot of people say, well, I want to exit. I would at least expect this. That has no meaning to the market, right? That has no meaning to the market. People would go and give only what you're worth at. You know, like I was selling one existing Subway and somebody came to me and said, I want to buy a sell at a Subway at 80 lakh rupees. I said, what would a new Subway would cost if I want to start a new Subway? Absolutely brand new equipment, brand new everything. In maybe in the great neighborhood at this stage, and especially this was actually in the COVID times going on. I say, and the COVID times, I'll get probably rentals, which is 30% cheaper. He said, maybe another 50, 55 lakh rupees. I said, then what makes me reason that I should invest 80 lakh rupees with you? That's one approach of it. But fundamentally, can we still argument, look, I'm already done the gestation. I'm already profitable. I have a top site available. All these arguments can come in. You can still get a goodwill, but you need to be realistic on what is your expectation on. If you just take expectation, most of the times people who are exiting the business, their expectation is what they've invested, at least that come out. That has no meaning to me. You know, that has no meaning to me. And I have seen businesses which were invested 10 crores and they were actually sold at nothing. You know, they took almost haircut and took a little bit fee money and then they exited because the investment they did was actually a cash burn. You know, this was not really anything which contributed to the company. So that's very, very important for you to understand that. How do you really do that? Another thing which comes to us is classic businesses, old businesses, which come to us and they say, I have good revenue and very controlled expenses. So I'm profitable, very profitable business and I want to sell that business. Now, in some cases, this I can discount it over some return on the capital, which is generating. And if it has stability, I can give a certain amount of valuation. Typically, I will do a valuation, which is say 14-15% of the capital deployed and I discount it back to the entire thing. But I will not give you a very big valuation on the business. Why I will not give you? Because fundamentally, what you're doing is that you're not reinvesting in the business. So what you're doing is you're keeping the expenses low. You're not growing the business. You're taking a lot of cash out and you're not reinvesting in the back end business. And so fundamentally to me, this is not a business designed for a larger growth, right? So that also is a problem. So like a lot of businesses are classic old businesses, very controlled. They just keep taking cash out for their own lifestyle and their own things and things like that. The business is not reinvested and the business has become flat and actually stagnant for very, very long. So those businesses also not really a big evaluation businesses. You know, the businesses will need to continue to show growth. They need to have some kind of trajectory of growth and where the business is going. And that's very important. Another area is that a lot of entrepreneurs who are very, the business is totally dependent on them. That also is not so valued. If you really want to make your business most valuable, make yourself redundant in your own business. This is something which I always say. You need to make yourself redundant because if you make yourself redundant, then your business model would be great to be transferred to somebody else. If the business is too dependent on you, again, you will not get a value. And a lot of businesses, and particularly one business of mine, I had a great term sheet, great valuation, everything. And the CEO said that this business is too much around you. And that was true because it's one of my franchise business and everybody knew me because of franchising. So I was too involved in that business. And it was a joint venture. It was a joint venture with a big company. And they felt that eventually they wanted to take a larger share in the business. And they said, because the business is too much around you. And if you're not there in the business, this would not make sense. So fundamentally, if you don't make your own business model redundant of you, you know, you're not required anymore in your business. That time, the valuation of the businesses goes to another side. Another area which we get, this is especially for small businesses. When we see the balance sheet of the small businesses, they come to us and I would see the finance and entire thing and bottom line is very low. And you ask them, why this is so low? He says, no. I put a lot of cost here and there. I've taken my own compensation, my car loans and my this and my that. And that's why the bottom line is so low. And this is my company. I want to save taxes and I put my things and my compensation, my salaries, my travel bills and other things. these all actually are wrong. You know, all takes away your valuation. This creates a lot of doubt and in people, and I've seen and this doesn't go with investors. They don't like it. They don't like a situation like these. They don't like the situation of things which are put in the business and which were not part of that. And so at this stage, I think we are in a very different sphere at this stage. More cleaner, more predictable, more scalable, more businesses which have a trajectory of what I said, showing very clearly a great a performance in past, good growth, good today, and a very excellent and extraordinary future. If you are able to demonstrate that, that's where you get the maximum value. Every business has an inherent value. There is an inherent value, and I always call it the SaaS principle. There has a subscriber value, there's an assets, and there is a strategic value. Between these three things, how do we really come out of the outcome of a value is very important. So now I'll be happy to take a few questions from Sonali, if you see any questions, because I have another 3 minutes to go. So any questions you have, I'll be more than happy to take it.
Sure, sir. So we have quite a few questions lined up with us. I'll just take the most relevant ones. So one of our attendee asks, why are valuations so high for startups when in reality they are actually in big losses?
Yes. So as I said, I mean, valuation is not done for today. It's done for future. These startups have a great ability to demonstrate that future. Now the problem, and this is actually a very surprising part, you know, this is actually because they don't have a past. So they put all the maths around showing what is future going to be, while this objectivity of what they're showing has to show with a lot of merits and maybe a little bit of a commercial performance they've done to demonstrate that. Look, they spend 100 rupees to get these 200 customers, and then they say, can, because they are 200, but the market is that big, and if I spend this much, I can get so much. So these are things which will tell them that there is a future on that. They will also have some clearly a problem solving value, which was clearly demonstrated to investor. They like the issue where you really solve a problem. You're solving a big problem, which would create a new customer base for you. So those are businesses which then gets a serious amount of value. And sometimes you need to take to early adapters, because you already know that this is going to be the next big thing. When e-commerce was invested in India, a lot of startups were investing. If you had any name, anything you called, and you had a platform which is ready and technology was ready, you will get money. Because everybody knew that money is chasing e-commerce for India. There's no brainer in that. So sometimes some industries I call are always chasing capital. They're always inviting a lot of capital. And if you are at the right time, right stage, you'll raise money. Absolutely. And I can tell you a couple of things which are in the entire thing. Like EduTech. There was no brainer. I mean, last year, EduTech, anybody was even early stage business would attract capital. There's no problem. But year from now, I don't think so. I don't think you, as a startup, you will be able to attract. Only the big boys would get even bigger. And then only strategic acquisition would happen, which means that you have a tool which Baiju's like, and Baiju's would buy you. You have some window here, and then somebody would buy you. So that's how the market would now really run and work. Now, the problem with business which are existing, they have a lot of past. And suddenly they behave like a startup and say, the next 5 years, I'm going to be 10x. But you have another 5 years behind you, which is not even showing a 2x. And how you can demonstrate 10x? And without changing anything which you're doing today, just because you ask money and say, give me $3 million and I will be 10x, nobody's going to buy you. So fundamentally is that even if you are an old business, and if you re-engineer this everything and really demonstrate that now you're ready for a new trajectory for a growth cycle, then I think so. Or you have a new technology, or you have a new innovation, and then you will be able to get that.
Absolutely. Wonderfully explained, sir. So another question we have is from Mr. Paramjeet Singh. He says, how do you value a brand name or logo which is already closed? For example, Kingfisher is all whited up, but only the logo and the brand name is there if they want to sell.
Actually, this is a big, good question. Very, very good question. All big private equity firms buy Chapter 11 companies, and just not because the company is anywhere dead and finished, and they buy logos. And logos become very, very big. And I can tell you some names which you would be surprised that there is no company existent on that. Kodak. Kodak packed up, logo was sold to a private equity. Polaroid, another camera company. Everything sold out, and logo was sold. Westinghouse, company closed, a brand was sold to another. So there are so many brands. This is very new to India. It's not been done so much, but it's a very, very popular way of buying business. Intangible assets sometimes become very important. Now, Kodak is licensing into everything. They are making eyewear, they're making laptops, they're making phones, they're making everything. They just, the owner of the trademark is using these names. And similarly, Kingfisher is a phenomenal brand, Rather, before it got packed up 5 years back, you know, Vijay Mallya and his core team really invited one of our licensing team, Bradford, to explore licensing, because he always knew what the power of his brand was. He always knew that. And it's unfortunate that he was not able to take it, because his idea was to really do a lot of things under licensing, bring fashion line, bring this line. This was all a part of the plan. But unfortunately, this took a different turn altogether. Now the asset is with banks. Obviously, the banks would eventually need to see that how they unlock it. But banks sometimes don't understand this. I personally, if I would have to give advice, I say auction the name and you'll get a good name. And now the problem would be that Kingfisher is not owned just by airline. This is owned by UB also, which is already sold to DIGO. So the brand owner, I don't know who is the brand owner and how the brands would be different, because the logos were differently placed. Kingfisher had a different logo and UB's beer logo was a little different. I don't know how was the license. It was a UB license to Kingfisher Airline or vice versa, because that is already, it's going on. Beer brand is already there. And they're actually, I think they've already started licensing. I've heard that they've licensed a brand for a non-alcoholic beer called Zero and Zero by Kingfisher. So they're doing brands. So it's a little complex in that sense, right?
So, sir, if your time permits, can we just take one more question? Sure. So another question we have is, why are valuation approaches different in different cases? For example, if I'm trying to raise funding, then it's different. But if I'm trying to sell my business or take a loan, then the valuation is different.
Yeah, sure. So it's as I said, in the start of the business, it's obviously would be absolutely different. If you're selling the business, then there is a deeper risk with the new buyer, because he has to run and manage the business, and you are completely exiting the business. And so there is a challenge of legacy, future handling, operation capability. A lot of things would come in the mind. But if you're running the business and you're going on the track and you invite me as a minority shareholder in the business, and I'm participating in the business, my investment is just limited to my financial investment, and I have very limited risk and operational contribution of business. So valuations would be absolutely different.
Right. Great, sir. So we don't have another question, but a comment that we have from Dr. Rekha. She says, make yourself self-redundant for high business valuation is great advice. And I've seen lots of exits due to self-dependence. So she did ask if you can give some cases, but I think you gave a case of yourself only for this. So yeah, I think that's absolutely right, Dr. Rekha. And sir, anything you would like to add to that, you would like to say in the end?
No, I think it's a good session. We continue to bring these sessions every Saturday. It's essentially designed for what I call early stage businesses and a lot of startups and businesses which want to sell their entire thing. So this is how, and we will make sure that we do our best to, from business X viewpoint, to continue to take up the knowledge up and help our business community retransit and network better. Thank you very much.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for your time, Gaurav sir, for a wonderful session as always, and for sharing your valuable insights with us. Thank you to all our attendees for attending the session. As Gaurav sir said, we'll see you next Saturday at 3 p.m. for another session. And the next session will be on exiting your business. So if you're interested in that, please join us next Saturday. Thank you so much.